the engineering structure consisting of straight members connected by at their ends by means of bolts, rivets, pins or welding. Okay, so they are the straight structural members basically connected at the end by means of your bolts, your rivets, pins or welding. Okay, so they can be made up of any material like your steel, aluminium tubes, wooden structures, metal bars or any angles or channels. Okay, so this is how they can be made up of. After this, truss offers practical, where is its application? So it find its application in your structural problems in engineering like power transmission, bridges, roofs of the buildings. Okay, so these are the application where you can see your trusses. And plane truss, now this term is important, all of you pay attention. Plane truss is defined as a truss whose members lie in a single plane, means only X and Y, Z or Y and Z or X or Z, any single plane it will work. Forces acting on such truss also lie in this plane. Okay, so this is about your theory of the truss. Now coming to its formulation, in the analysis that follow, it is assumed that members are connected by smooth pin. This is the assumption that you must keep in your mind. What is the assumption? That the members are connected by smooth pins and by ball and socket joint. Okay, in case of three-dimensional trusses, keep this in mind. In the previous slide, I told you two-dimensional trusses. Here, we are saying in case of three-dimensional truss, the assumption is the truss members are connected by smooth pins or by ball and socket joint. So this is your joint. This is your joint location. Numberings are done over here, 1, 2, 3. So they are done by smooth pins. Okay. And one more thing, you will see on this right-hand side figure that on this member is in compression. Okay. And this member is in tension and this member is in compression. Compression means you can see the direction of the force of application. The force is applied in this direction, whereas for this horizontal member, the force is applied in this direction. So it is in tension. So only we have forces in either compression or tension. What's my point? Suppose we draw a coordinate axis over here. Suppose the horizontal is your x-axis and vertical is your y-axis. So here you can clearly see that in x direction there is some force, if this is your force F, but in y direction, that is your Fy, there is no force. Okay, similarly for this also, for this member, suppose I will draw some coordinate system. Sorry, this is in line with axial bar and this is perpendicular to that bar. Okay, so this is your X and this is your Y. So again, here you can see there is some Fx value minus it because it is in compression, and at the same time, here your vertical forces. Okay, so important assumptions deals here. Another assumption, the way loads are applied, all the loads must be applied at the joint only. Keep this in the first, the members are connected by smooth pins or by ball and socket joint. The another assumption is the loads will be always applied on the joints only. Okay, this assumption is true for most situation because are designed so that majority of the load is applied to the joint only. Okay, so all the load, wherever you will see loads will be applied only at the joint only. Okay, so you keep this in your mind. Now we are going to do its finite element formulation. Okay, now on the left hand side, this side you can see one balcony truss. Okay, so of this balcony truss, you can see it is made up of element, one element, second element, third element, 4, 5, and 6 elements. Have 6 elements and they are connected via some nodes. So for node, take some another color. Okay. So this is your node 1. I will try to keep it in square box. Node number 2, node 3, node number 4, and node number 5. Okay. So here we have 5 nodes and 6 elements. Elements are 6 in numbers and nodes are 5 number. Okay, and you can see here the application of this load. Load is applied on node number 4 and node number 5. This is a typical example of a balcony truss. Balcony truss. Okay, now come to its finite element formulation. That is the most important part. All of you, be mentally and physically present, because this is very, very important. Okay, it's derivation. Now we will see one derivation of this finite element formulation. So all of you must keep attention, and this is our final end result that we are looking for. This is your element stiffness matrix for your truss element. Okay, so this matrix we are going to derive. How this cos and sine thetas are coming, we will see now. This is very simple if you will pay attention. This is difficult if you will not pay attention. Yeah, coming again to this slide, finite element formulation. So you can start with this figure. Here you can see I have taken one element, suppose any one of them. Okay, so for timing you can consider I have taken this element number 5 over here. So for this element number 5, we have 2 nodes. So here we are representing the node numbers with I and J. The lower one is your node number I and this upper one is your node number J. Okay, now here we have 2 coordinate system. Keep this in your mind. The first one is your global coordinate system and the second one is your local coordinate system. You can see here local coordinate system is written, and the orientation of local coordinate system, you can see its x-axis is aligned along this truss element and y-axis is just perpendicular to it. Okay, y-axis is just perpendicular to it. Okay, now try to understand what is this local and what is this global coordinate system. Suppose for this balcony truss, okay, you can see if we will consider one coordinate system for the entire problem, then let me draw x and y axis. X axis and this is your y axis. Okay, so based on this coordinate system, I will find the orientation of each and every trusses. Like suppose for element number 1, it is along x axis, so it is making, I will write here element 1 is making 0 degree with x axis, and with y axis it is making minus 90 degree. Okay, is it correct? Please respond. Are you able to understand?
sir.
Okay. Now, coming to element number 2, if you will see, element number 2 is making this angle with x-axis, whereas it is making this angle with y-axis. So, element number 2 is making, if this is 90 and this is theta, so it is making an angle 90 plus theta with x, whereas it is making theta with y-axis. So, likewise, we can tell the orientation of each and every element with your x-axis and y-axis. Okay, and you can see for all the elements, I am taking this as your coordinate axis, that is your x and y. Okay, so this is considered as global coordinate system. Why? Because this coordinate system is acceptable, or it is applicable to each and every element present in our problem statement. Okay, whereas if suppose I have to work separately for each element, then what I will do, for suppose element number 1, this is my coordinate axis. For element number 2, this is my coordinate axis. One, we have to consider along the axis of your element, and the another axis, that is the y, that will be perpendicular to that element. Okay, now coming to this element, one along the axis and one perpendicular to it. For element number 4, one along the axis and one perpendicular to it. Similarly, for element number 6, one along the axis and one perpendicular to it, and element number 3, one along the axis and one perpendicular to it. So here you can see we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 elements and 6 local coordinate systems. So for every element, if I am considering a separate coordinate system, so that coordinate system will be called as your local coordinate system. Okay. Is this clear to all of you? Say yes or no.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now let's see ahead. For every node, suppose, for every node, for I have taken one element from that balcony truss, this is my element. So I have here 2 nodes, one represented by I, and here it is J. Okay, now you can see at every node, this coordinate axis are drawn. One with your capital UIX. What does that mean? It means capital U is representing your global coordinate system, this capital letter. Okay, whereas this small letter you can see here, small UIX, small UIX is representing your local coordinate system. Okay, now here I is representing your node number, and again you can see here capital X is here. So this expression is telling you capital U means your global displacement at node number I in X direction. Okay, now you can see here capital UIY. So this is your displacement at node number Y in Y, at node number I in Y direction. Okay, so these two are your global coordinate system, displacement at node number I. Okay, similarly at node number J, you have capital U J into X. Okay, capital U J into X, and here capital U J into Y. Okay, so this capital U is representing that it is global coordinate system. This J is representing that it is for node number J, and this X is representing your direction, that this is in X direction, whereas this is in Y direction. So I hope it is clear to all of you.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so now let's move ahead. Now coming to your, we have talked about this global coordinate system represented by capital U. Now coming to this small u, now you can see its orientation. As I have told you earlier, one along the axis, I am using this green color. You can see there. So here, small u ix. So it is representing your small means local coordinate system, means for this specific particular element. I means for node number I it is acting, and x means x direction we are considering in axial direction along the axis of your element. Okay, now if you will see this one, this small u is representing local coordinate system, I is representing node number I, and y is representing y direction. Okay, so this is for node number I. Similarly, you can see at node number j also, along the axis it will be u j x. Perpendicular to this axis it will be u j y. Got it? So these are 1, 2, 3, 4. If we talk about this local and global displacement, okay, displacement, these are displacement terms. Okay, so here one question I would like to arise here. For every node we are observing 2 degrees of freedom, one in your x direction, one in your y direction. Okay, so as we have in previous axial bar or spring element, number of nodes was deciding the degree of freedom or your order of matrix of global stiffness matrix. I hope you all remember this. Okay, so there for every node there was only 1 degree of freedom, so the number of node was equals to order of your global stiffness matrix. Here you can see for every node 2 degrees of freedom are there. I will write here, for every node 2 degrees of freedom are here. So our order of matrix, order of global stiffness matrix, global stiffness matrix, it will be number of nodes into 2. So here how many nodes do we have? Here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Very good. So 5 nodes. So the order of your global stiffness matrix for this specific problem, for this balcony truss problem, it will be 5 into 2 equals to 10. 10 cross 10 will be the order of matrix for global stiffness matrix for this balcony truss problem. Okay, if the number of nodes will reduce, then your order of the element stiffness matrix will change. You all must keep this in your mind. Okay, now here we have to find out the relation between this global and local coordinate system. Okay, there are some relation because here some theta value is there, so let me clear it. At this node I am clearing what I have written so that I can explain you. Yeah, okay, now coming to this node number I. Okay, now can we write, capital UIX? Okay, focus on this term, capital UIX. Okay, and this angle is theta. So what will be its component? Component of this, if I want to put on this, then what it will become? UIX cos theta. Okay, so let me write here, capital U into I x equals to small u I x cos theta. Okay, now we have taken the component of this on your global coordinate system. Now coming to this y term, okay, this y term, if this is theta, so this will be 90 minus theta, and again this will be theta, okay, and this will be your 90 minus theta. So if you will take its component on x axis, so it will go in opposite direction, so we will keep minus sign and it will become u I into y cos of 90 minus theta. Cos 90 minus theta is, anyone from the class?
Sin theta. Minus sin theta.
No, sin theta only, not minus sin theta. Minus is here because we are going in opposite direction. Okay, so that's why I will write here sin theta. So this is how we can break its component into, this is your, actually we are trying to establish a relation between your global coordinate system and local coordinate system. So this is at node number I in x direction. So step by step you remember. Now global coordinate system u at node number I in y direction equals to, now we will break its component. Okay, so what will be that? Okay, so here u I y, it will be this component. Now let me again clear it. Okay, now I am willing to write for this u I y. Okay, so what will be its component? If this is your theta, so this will be the component of this small u I x along vertical axis. So it will become small u I x, and here it will be which sine or cos? This is theta, so this will be 90 minus theta. Okay, so it will become u I x sine theta, and the component of this one, so if this is 90 minus theta, so it will be theta, so its component will be plus, because it is going in vertical upward direction. So I will write plus u small u I into y into cos theta. Is that clear? Is there any difficulty in writing this? I'm just putting the components of small u on capital U. If you have any difficulty, you ask me. Now, coming to your node number J, okay, for node number J, what I will do, we can write capital U, now J X equals to, now this is your capital U J X. Okay, now its component across this, so everything will remain the same, only this I will become J. Okay, so here you can write small u into small u J X cos theta minus small u J Y sine theta. Okay, similarly capital U J Y, it will be your small u J X sine theta plus small u into J into Y cos theta. Now tell me if there is any difficulty in this equation. You tell me,
sir. Sir, yes. Can you repeat again the second equation, sir?
Okay, I will explain it once again, don't worry. Let me erase this for clarity. Yeah, I am clearing at node number J. Okay, for x you understand how to write?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so for Y, you see for node number J, how to write? Okay, so now I'm coming here. UJX, capital UJX. This is your theta angle. Okay, so can I write U, capital U, node number J, X direction equals to this component of this small UJX. Here it is theta. So it will be small U, JX cos theta. Now the component of this on X axis, if you remember, it was going in opposite direction. This is your theta. So it will become minus of small U, J into Y, and this will be your sine theta. Okay. This is for JX I have written. Now for this one, U, J, Y, here I will write capital U, J, Y equals to, now component of this small u, j, x on this one. This is theta. So this angle will become 90 minus theta. Okay, cos of 90 minus theta is sine theta. So it will become small u, j, x, sine theta. It is in vertical upward direction. So plus, now the component of this, this is also theta. So it will become plus u, J, Y, cos theta. Okay. So these are the two expressions that I have written here. This is for 1, 2, 3, and 4 equations. Okay. Is it clear to all of you? Up to here, it is clear to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now let's move on to the next slide. So this is exactly what we have obtained in the previous slide that I have written here. You can see these are the four equations. These are your four equations. Okay, now if you watch this equation carefully, what you will observe, you can write this in matrix form. Okay, you can write this in matrix form, where on right hand side of this equals to sign, you have uix, uiy, ujx, ujy. This will be your right hand side. Equals to, there will be some sine and cos theta matrix, and on this side you can write small uix, small uiy, small ujx, and small ujy. So this will be your another column matrix. Now you can watch carefully, and you can yourself tell me where will be sine and where will be cos. Suppose for this U, capital UIX, and here UIX, some factor is there. What is that? Cos theta. So you can write here cos theta. Now UIY minus sine theta. So you can write minus sine theta. Now UJX, there is no term related to here, UIX and small u, JX. So what we will do, we will keep 0, 0. Now coming to second line, UIY, capital IY, here UIX sine theta. So here it will become sine theta. Here UIY means second term, so cos theta. Now again, there is no term related with JX and JY. So 0 and 0, you can write here. Now come here, UJX, here no IX term, so 0, 0, cos theta, minus sine theta. Similarly, 0, 0, sine theta, cos theta. So this is the transformation matrix. What we are transforming? Coordinate system to global coordinate system. So this sine and cos theta matrix, what we have obtained here, that is your transformation matrix. Now let's see what I have written over here on the slide. Two frame of reference are required to describe the truss problem. First is your global coordinate system. Let me take red color for better visibility. Yeah. Two frame of reference here you have. First one is your global coordinate system and another is your local frame of reference. Okay. Why do we fix this global coordinate system? So to represent the location of each joint and to keep the track of orientation, that from there you can get the value of theta that we have already discussed. Okay. Another is to apply the constraints and apply the loads in terms of their global component. Means if you remember that balcony truss example, where to apply the load, which one will be fixed. So for that you need some global component, and to represent the solution, that is displacement of each joint in global direction. So for these three reasons, you need your global coordinate system. Now, we need a local and an elemental coordinate system to describe the force member behavior, and the relationship between this point is very important. This point is very important. The relationship between your local element and your global description as shown in the figure. So what is the relation? How you can relate your global and local coordinate system? For that we have derived this equation. Okay, now this is written what I have told you earlier. Global displacement uix uiy at node I, ujx uJy at node number j are related to local displacement small uix small uiy at node I. Okay, small ujx small jy at node number j. So now this we have derived, and this matrix, let us go to the next slide. Yeah, this is exactly what is written here in matrix format that I have written here. Okay, that we have written in next slide, that we can write this capital U matrix, okay, equals to T into small u, where capital U is this global displacement matrix, this, oh sorry, let me erase this or it will create confusion. This T is your transformation matrix and this U is your small u or local displacement matrix. Okay, now this is up to here. If you will solve, it is only half of the derivation. Still we have a long derivation. Okay, so I need your full attention. Capital U and small u represent the displacement of node I and J with respect to your global and local frame of reference, whereas T, this capital T is transformation matrix. Many times for short question, this question is asked, what is transformation matrix? Write the transformation matrix for truss element. In that situation, you have to write this matrix. In that situation, you have to write this matrix. For short question, it is important. Okay, now, for displacement, we have find out the relation. Now we will find out the relation between force term. Capital F is representing your global force, whereas the small f is representing your elemental force. So same figure, in place of U, capital U, you are having capital F. In place of small u, you have small f. This is the only difference. Remaining equations are also same. If you will see here, only difference is for u, you are writing f. We are doing only transformation of capital F to your small f. Okay. This you can see here, cos theta minus sin theta, cos theta minus sin theta, here sin theta, cos theta, here sin theta, here cos theta. Similarly, cos minus sin in third equation, and in the last final equation, sin theta and your cos theta. So this is your sin theta and this is your cos theta. Okay, so this is exactly the same. Only thing is, in place of capital U, I am writing capital F and small f. Capital F is your force in terms of global coordinate system. Small f is representing the force in your elemental coordinate system. Okay, coming to the next slide. This is what the relation we found out. Capital F equals to transpose matrix and transformation matrix into your elemental force matrix, where capital F is this and T is your transformation matrix that we have already seen in the previous slide. This is your transformation matrix, same it will be there for displacement as well as force, and this small f is your force matrix in local coordinate system, local component, okay, at node number I and j. Now we have, till now what we have established, the relation in the previous slides, we have established the relation between your global displacement equals to transformation matrix into your local force component. Okay, so this is, we have find out the relation between displacement at local and global coordinate system. Displacement, we have found out the relationship between force at local and global coordinate system. Okay, now the next turn is relationship between force and displacement. Force and displacement. So we all know that from first class, I am telling you, F equals to K into X. Normally, we consider this for your spring. So same funda is applicable over here also. At node number I, suppose this is your displacement UIX. Okay. So what force term we can write? We can write FIX, force, local force at node I in X direction will be equals to your stiffness into UIX, means displacement at node number in X direction minus displacement at node number J in X direction. Okay. Similarly, FY, vertical direction, as I have to force in Y direction at node number I, Y direction, it will be zero. First slide I have told you. Now coming to your node number, at node number J, F X equals to stiffness K into U J X minus U I X in X direction only. Okay, so this is your force. What is written over here? Force at node number J in X direction. Okay, again, at node number J, small f, J, Y, it will equals to zero. So we have obtained first equation, second equation. This will be your third equation. And this is your fourth equation. So four equation you can see written over equation number one, equation number, this is your third equation and this is your fourth equation. And again, you will watch it carefully. You can write it in matrix form. Matrix. This RHS will become a column matrix that is represented over then this K term, that is your stiffness matrix, this is stiffness matrix. This is your displacement matrix. This we have seen in previous chapter also. This is your displacement matrix. This is your nodal. Okay. This is nothing but what equation obtained here, we have written here in matrix form. Okay. So from here, what we are obtaining, relation between force and displacement. Means here, this equation, we can write it like in matrix F equals to K is your stiffness matrix into U, small u I am writing, okay. This is your displacement matrix. This we can write, okay. And earlier, what we have obtained, some relation for F. What is F? Here, from this equation, we can write F equals to T inverse of this transformation matrix into this capital F. We can write or not? We can write like this, okay? So same, I am writing here, you can write inverse of this transformation matrix into capital F and K will be as it is. And this U also, you can write inverse of your transformation matrix into capital U. So we will rewrite that equation. This is exactly what I have explained you now. Yeah, here. So you can write it like this. For small f, I have written T inverse into capital F. And for the small u, I can write T inverse into capital U. Okay. T, what is T? T is your transformation matrix. Here we have derived out. This is your transformation matrix given by this. So this cos theta, sine theta, you can calculate its inverse and you will get this as your T inverse. Now, T inverse is known to you, F is known to you, okay? Or if we multiply this T on left hand side and right hand side of this equation, then that equation will modify and will become this equation. Okay, so now here on left hand side you have only force term, on right hand side this capital T is representing your transformation matrix, K is your stiffness matrix, T inverse is your inverse of your transformation matrix, and U is your displacement matrix. When you substitute T, K you can take it from here, this is your K matrix. When you substitute that value on over here and this T inverse, what you will get? You will get this term, this big matrix that you can see here. When you will multiply this T, let me take a red color. Yeah, when you multiply this T matrix, K matrix and T inverse matrix, you will get this entire term. I am highlighting in red color. Okay, so this is that global stiffness matrix. This is your stiffness matrix. Okay, so in your examination, question can be asked like derive element stiffness matrix. For truss element, so this is the derivation that you have to do. Okay, is there any doubt? Now you can ask me. If you have, anyone have any doubt, you can ask me.
Sir, it is for only one element.
It is for only one element, okay. And you can see here the order of this matrix. Order of this matrix is 1, 2, 3, 4 cross 4. So, as we have considered one element, and at one element node number I and node number J, and at every node you have considered 2 degrees of freedom, UIX, UIY. Similarly, at this node you have taken UJX and here UJY. So, two at every node, you have two nodes. So, the order of this stiffness matrix is 4. 2 into 2 equals to your 4. Okay. So, this is for one element. If your number of element will increase, then individually you have to find out the stiffness matrix for all element. Then you have to assemble to get global stiffness matrix. We will solve one numerical based on this truss problem. Then more clarity will come. Okay, in next class we will solve one numerical based on it. Still, you have any doubt, you are welcome, you can ask me. Or if it is clear, is it clear? Say yes or no.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so that is good. And you must revise this derivation, I am telling you, because it is very important. Okay, so you must, this is long derivation, so you need it to practice it. Okay, once or twice you will practice it, then it will be permanently stored in your mind. So that's all from my side. If you have anything to ask, you can ask me, or else you can leave the meeting. Have a nice day.
Sir, mid exams kab se?
For your mid examination, till now I have no information, but you prepare first 3 units. Whatever is taught by the end of this week, that will be asked in your examination.
Sir, it will be online or offline?
That is also, I have no information till now. If I will get any information that it will online or offline, it will be circulated to you on your official WhatsApp group.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So, now I'm going to download your attendance list. One by one, or it is downloading or not.
Sir, already some students are reviewed this meeting.
It is downloaded. I have downloaded it. Okay. Okay. So now one by one, all of you leave the meeting.